If you have your Bibles with you, I'd like for you to turn with me in the Old Testament to the book of 2 Kings. 2 Kings, chapter 5. There's too much scripture here that I want to read to put it on the screen, so we can't be techie today. And I want you to keep your Bibles open to this fifth chapter while we read, not all of it, but a good portion of it. We've been, for several Sundays, talking about sanctification. It is a doctrine throughout Scripture. It's also sometimes fraught with contention and with confusion. The simplest way we can define God's whole plan of salvation is that He has a work He does in our heart that deals with the commission of sins, the habitual practice of disobedience. That disobedience, habitual, willful disobedience, brings guilt and causes separation from God and a state of enmity, really. And we're under a sentence of death. We are, when we are saved, when we're forgiven, when we are converted, when we're born again, when we are born of the Spirit, those are all synonyms for when we first meet God and get right with God. Our sinning past is forgiven, and a new strength is in our heart to resist the temptation to return to it. The chains of sin are broken, and we can, by the help of God, live according to Titus' words, to say no to ungodliness and worldly lusts and live righteously and godly, he said, in this present evil world. Everyone that reads the Bible carefully at all, and I won't belabor this, but there's virtually no one who believes that that's finishes God's dealing with sin, because what has been dealt with in that work is the commission of sin, living in outward rebellion against God. After that ceases, universal Christian experience everywhere in Scripture, Old and New Testament, points out that there lingers something in our heart that we're born with. The Bible calls it the sinful nature. And that is the root of all practicing of sin anyway. It's really the fundamental problem that we have. It is an inclination to reject God's claims upon me. It troubles, hinders, partially cripples Christian walk, so that the Scripture uses a very graphic term, really, that we're double-souled. We have dual motivations. We have dual pulls in our hearts. And it results in an unstable Christian walk, one that is plagued with inconsistency. The probably two wonderful illustrations are the wanderings of the children of Israel in the wilderness and the 3 years of the disciples following Jesus, characterized by heights and lows. This is the greatest thing to be a Christian, to follow Jesus, whatever. And then when Jesus disappoints, when God's will seems to be different, we take a different tact, and there is something unstable about that kind of Christian life. And there are two things then that kind of rise to the top. One, there's a hunger that God puts in our heart to be free of that. He's the one that puts a hunger in my heart to want consistency and want to be able to walk with God without that up and down stuff. And there is everything in Scripture that we run across that talks about cleansing, talks about purity of heart, talks about cutting away the sinful nature, an operation on my heart to get rid of that inclination. Those commands are meant to attract to that hunger in our heart, to be better, to be victorious, to be different. And I think there are lots and lots of illustrations in Scripture, but this chapter 5 of 2 Kings is a good story of a man who has leprosy. Let me just take a sentence or two to establish authority for using leprosy as an illustration of not sinning, but of the infection of sin that we're born with. Leprosy is everywhere in Old and New Testament, used as a type of a condition of sin. Not an act, but a condition. And that condition of sin, it's interesting, you see a lot of it in the Gospels. We hear about leprosy a lot. Jesus healing lepers. I'm using the word healing, okay? Nothing wrong with that. But it's significant that in all of the four Gospels and all of the references to leprosy and all of the references to Jesus healing lepers, the word healing is really not used. All of them, save one, are translated, the original word is cleansed, not forgiven. Deeds of sin, commission of sin, willful transgression needs forgiveness, not cleansing. Leprosy is a disease, a condition, and it does not need forgiving. It needs cleansing. That's the core of God's work in the heart of a Christian, curing us of that double-souledness. And it's very significant that everywhere in the Gospels, leprosy is spoken of as being cleansed. Now, here in 2 Kings, let me just begin to read, and rather than read all of it, then go back through and give you some kind of an outline, I want to just speak to you as you follow this passage of Scripture, some observations here. Now Naaman, captain of the army of the king of Aram, that's the Syrians, that's Aram is one of three or four names for Syria. Now Naaman, captain of the army of the king of Aram, was a great man with his master and highly respected, because by him the Lord had given victory to Aram. The man was also a valiant warrior. Quickly, this guy is not dead in a sinful sense. When we are rebels, we're dead in trespasses and sins, acts, deeds. This guy wasn't dead. He's alive. He's actually doing pretty well. He's a 5-star general. He has a good reputation. He is known as a valiant warrior. He's a great man. And notice, it says, the Lord used him. God brought victory to Syria against Assyria, which is then Nineveh, today Mosul. God brought victory for this little country of Assyria against the big neighborhood bully at the time, which was Assyria, capital in Nineveh. God used him. Listen, when we're Christians, shifting gears now spiritually, When we become a Christian, we have life. And God uses us. And we walk with God, and we work for God. And we ought to have a reputation as they're different than they used to be. He was a great man. This whole verse is filled with compliments, praise, legitimate, justified praise. God praises us and loves us and assures us when we are born again. Jesus told his disciples after they returned from a little mission trip he sent them on, gave them power to cast out demons and heal and all that, and they came back and they were really buzzed because of all those things they could do, and Jesus corrected them. He said, don't be rejoicing about that. I was there, he said, when Satan got thrown out of heaven. I know all about that. But he said, rather, you rejoice because your names are written in heaven. What a privilege to be born again and walk with God, know that God's in my heart. Naaman, in this type, in this illustration, was not dead in trespasses and sins. But, what does it say? That whole wonderful verse, all the good stuff. But he was a leper. Leprosy always starts out very insignificantly. You don't just all of a sudden get slammed with it. It is very insignificant, very small. It's very slow. Many people will go 20 years with some of these different skin diseases that collect under the name of leprosy. They'll go 20 years with very little pain, suffering, little disruption of their life. It's very slow, and that's part of the reason God uses leprosy as a good example of sin. It's very subtle. It's slow. It doesn't raise red flags if we kind of harbor it in our hearts. I'll be fine. And Naaman could say, listen, I know I'm a leper, but let's don't harp on that too much. I mean, man, I'm a great man with my master. I'm a mighty warrior. I'm a valiant man on a personal level. I'm not an armchair general. I go out with the men. I lead them. I'm great. But he's a leper. What's the problem with that? Well, leprosy, as I mentioned, is gradual, but it's deadly. And it always leads to separation. That day, lepers weren't allowed to just completely mingle, depending on the level you had. And he apparently didn't have a horrible case of it. Maybe was able to keep it pretty well hidden. Lots of carnal Christians kind of lukewarm can do a pretty good job of hiding it. And that bent doesn't seem to trouble them too much. Causes a lot of worry. But I want you to notice this. The people closest to him knew it. You understand what I mean? If there's still something down in my heart that makes me an inconsistent Christian, and I've got a lopsided walk, and there are times when I get off the rails spiritually. Naaman's wife knew it. The little Israelite servant girl knew about it. They'd seen it in action. They'd sensed it. The king knew it. It was getting out. Naaman's a leper. Naaman's a leper. So obviously there had been some conversations, and the little servant girl told her mistress, Naaman's wife, there's a prophet in Israel. I wish he could go there and he'd be healed. Well, Naaman heard it. To Naaman's credit, he wanted to be rid of leprosy. He didn't want to be a leper. He'd seen people in the latter stages of it. He didn't want to be a leper. He wanted to be cleansed. He wanted to be rid of this leprosy on his soul, if you look at it spiritually. Bad enough that he went to the king. And he went in. Verse 4, Naaman went in to the king, told his master, saying, "Thus and thus spoke the girl who is from the land of Israel." Then the king of Aram said, "Go now, and I will send a letter to the king of Israel." He, that's Naaman, departed and took with him 10 talents of silver. A talent is a measure, it's a weight, and it varies, as far as people know, it's anywhere from 60 to 75 pounds. So he took, let's just say it's 60. He had 600 pounds of silver. You can get that through Rosalind, what is it? Buy silver. It's low. There's a reason it's low. But anyway. And then he had 6,000 shekels of gold. Estimates, they're all over the place because you don't know for sure what the weights are. But he had probably, in addition to the clothes, $100,000. So he takes off. He brought the letter to the king of Israel saying, verse 6, "And now as this letter comes to you, behold, I have sent Naaman, my servant, to you, that you may cure him of his leprosy." When the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his clothes, which was a sign of distress. They just ripped their clothes up. He tore his clothes and said, "Am I God to kill and to make alive that this man is sending word to me to cure a man of his leprosy? But consider now and see how he is seeking a quarrel against me." He knows I can't do this. The Syrians are at it again. They're trying to start a war, and he's sending me with an impossible task. And when I can't do it, that'll be his pretense for attacking me. It happened when Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, that he sent word to the king saying, "Why have you torn your clothes? Now let him come to me, and he shall know that there is a prophet in Israel." Let me just stop there for a minute. Naaman knew he had a disease. He knew he needed a cure, and he was hoping there was one. But notice how he went about it. It was all in his own strength. And he thought he could even, in this case, buy it with money, if I know the right people. And the king of Israel, at this time, I think he represents, I don't want to get too far off the path here, he represents the segment of the Christian church that denies there's anything that can be done about this leprosy of the soul. It didn't even occur to him, the king of Israel. "Why can't he heal? You can't be." The little servant girl, captive girl of Israel, knew better than the king did. Naaman went to the wrong place. He meant well. God got him to the right place finally, but he sought to the wrong place in the wrong way. Money, my own prestige, my own abilities, and I go to the king. He'll fix it. Well, Elisha hears about it, and so he says, "Send him to me." Verse 9. So Naaman came with his horses and his chariots and stood at the doorway of the house of Elisha. This is a tremendous verse of scripture. Nobody of that stature traveled alone. They had an entourage, the likes of which. First of all, think of the guards you've got to have to guard that much money. You know, these weren't banknotes or whatever. This is the real stuff. It's loaded up on animals. It's maybe in wagons. You've got to have all kinds of guards. You've got an entourage. This guy, this was a presidential motorcade. And he pulls up to the front door of Elisha's house. Now, no one, just looking at commentators, nobody thinks Elisha was well-to-do or whatever. So it was probably a fairly humble home that Elisha lived in. And up with, you know that Naaman didn't have any mangy horses that were scrawny. And I mean, he's got matched chariot horses, and he's got, I mean, the brass is polished, and things are great. Boy, this is an entourage the likes of which. And they roll up, and the dust is rolling, and they come to a stop, and there's this huge gathering of soldiers, armor. Dust begins to settle. Naaman stands there in his chariot. I'm sure he's standing good and straight. He's a general. What's he doing? I'm Naaman. You come out to me. Now, I'm not making that up, because we'll see in about two verses. And Elisha gave him a dose of exactly what he needed. He sent some kid, probably, a boy. When you wheel the garbage can out to the curb, tell him to go dip in the Jordan seven times and he'll be clean. We know, we learn something here about the core nature of the sinful nature, what it's really like, what its characteristics are, what its core is, by how he reacted. Elisha sent a messenger saying, go and wash in the Jordan seven times. Your flesh will be restored to you and you will be clean. What in the world's the matter with that? For goodness sakes, I'm going to be free of leprosy? What's his response? Naaman was furious. Went away and said, now here, he basically in his confession, he lets us know what the core issue is. Naaman was furious and went away and said, behold, I thought, or it says, I said in my heart, my inner thoughts were, he will surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God and wave his hand over the place and cure the leper. I'll get attention. Because after all, I'm Naaman. Now, let me just take a second here. I use the phrase, it's a biblical term, it's correct, that we have, even as Christians within our hearts, a bent to sinning. But I don't know sometimes if I shouldn't do a better job of explaining that. A lot of times when we think of sinning, we think of the horrible stuff. A bent to sinning to some people might mean, you know, I'm teetering on the edge of, you know, running off with the office secretaries. I am, you know, I'm always thinking that maybe I could, you know, sell cocaine. I'm just always on the edge of my seat when I go past a convenience store because I think about holding it up. That's not what's in our heart. It's not a bent to hellacious kind of sin. It's a condition, it's an attitude, it's a motivation, it's a disposition of the heart. And it's like the insignificance in early stages of leprosy, it's barely noticeable. So it is not the ugly kind of sin. It's just the tendency of how we react when self doesn't get its way. Dr. Taylor, whose books we have, and I quote him a lot, one time told me, he'd come to my church, he was preaching there, and he got involved with some people wanted to talk to him, and he was trying to help them and spiritually. And he told them, and then told him something, and then told me what he told him. He said, you can really tell what's in a person's heart by how they behave when they don't get their own way. Now, that's not shooting people. That's not selling drugs to little kids. That's not pornography. That's not being a part of El Chapo's ring. It's just a disposition in here that sometimes is barely discernible. Naaman, it got smoked out with Naaman by the response of Elisha. Man, I thought he'd come out here and make over me because after all, who I am. Now listen, you don't have to be a Naaman. True greatness, true money, whatever else. Everybody who hasn't had that removed has a deep tendency to come to life when me gets offended, gets hurt. Now, Naaman, by the way, Naaman, and I think this probably fits with his military position, what was his response? Well, if anybody had been very near, he'd taken their head off. So it was rage. It says here, he went away in a rage. Everybody doesn't respond like that. Lots of people just, I've been hurt. You know anybody like that? One's not any better than the other. Every one of us are wired, our temperament's a little bit different, and the infection will reveal itself in certain pretty predictable ways. Paul, in fact, calls this inner bent a law. It's just like gravity. You roll a ball off the edge of the kitchen table, it's going to drop. If you got any sense at all, you start seeing a pattern. Okay? Naaman threw a fit, wild-eyed fit, lashes his horses, rides off. It's a mayhem kind of a deal. A lot of people don't do that, but they just mope, pout, get embittered, and go like that sometimes months or years. And they remember, you slighted me, you did this, you didn't do that. I think there's something else about Naaman that's interesting here. Notice every version, generally, NIV, King James, different versions of Scripture, have the same wording here in verse 11. He'll wave his hand over the place and cure what? Me? No. I don't want to read too much in, but does he say cure me? No. Cure the leper. I don't want to say for sure publicly, I'm a leper. He knew he was, but man, I hate to admit that. And so he hedges. He does his best to downplay this infection that he has, this condition. So rather than say, I need cleansing in my heart, it's, I thought he would cure the leper. He just stays a quarter of an inch away from having to just face it and say it, I'm the guy. That makes sense? That's another characteristic of that bent. It's to avoid calling it what it is. Now, further, he says, are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean? So we turned and went away in a rage. This is irrational, but the carnal, still infected heart is irrational. You're going to get rid of leprosy. Well, he didn't believe. That's another key core issue. He didn't believe that this would work. He didn't believe that this was the answer. In one sense, it's too simple. His servants came near and spoke to him and said, my father, had the prophet told you to do some great thing, would you not have done it? How much more then when he says to you, wash and be clean? What a statement from his servants who loved him, cared for him. So it tells us something else about him. He was a good guy. And they came near to him and said, what a statement. How much when he says, wash and be clean? That's all God's saying to us. I can't take all the time today, and I won't stay on this subject until you're sick and tired of it. But I'll get in, say more things next week. But in a lot of ways, to get a clean heart for a believer is not that hard of a thing. It's not that big of a deal. It is a big deal. But just trust. It's like the leper came to Jesus, stood afar off, and he called to him. And he said, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. You can make me clean. And Jesus, remember, nobody touched the leper. Well, showing the absolute omnipotent might of God, Jesus went over, put his hand on him. Nobody did that, but Jesus did. Why? Leprosy can't affect him, but he can affect leprosy. And so he went over and he laid his hand on him. He says, I am willing. Be clean. And it says, immediately his leprosy was cleansed. Here, it's that simple. Just go wash and be clean. Pay the price that God wants you. Meet his conditions. What are his conditions, really? Well, we'll see them here in the very next verse. What's really the condition that especially Naaman needed to meet? So, he, what? He went down. He went down. Now, I know it means he went down the riverbank, but it means more than that. Naaman needed to go down, but he did. He had to die to Naaman. And Naaman's pomp and Naaman's agenda and Naaman's reputation and Naaman's influence. And he went down. Went down the bank, went down the river, dipped down 7 times, came up. His flesh had returned like the flesh of a child, and he was clean. And he was becoming clean, and he was continuing to become clean for all the rest of his life. Didn't say that. He was clean. That's instantaneous. That's completed work. It's clean. God bears witness when our hearts have been made clean. So he goes back. I want you to know this. Here's some changes. Here's some differences. Instant differences. Again, somewhat obscured, not real obvious. When the town drunk gets saved and, you know, the income at Jake's drops, it's more obvious. It's often more obvious when a wild-eyed sinner gets saved because they quit stuff. This is a little more different because sanctification deals heavily on internal motives, tendencies, appetites, agendas, motivations. When he returned to the man of God with all his company, notice here, it says, he came and stood before him. He didn't stand out, he didn't stay in his chariot out in the front door and repeat this business of expecting Elijah to come out. He says, he came with all this bunch, and says he went in and stood before him. See that? There's a change in the man's attitude. There's a humility. There is a willingness to be pliable and teachable. He got little in his own sight. So he goes in and he says, behold, I know that there's no God in all the earth but in Israel. So please take a present. And the word here is blessing. Take a blessing. From who? What's he call himself here? Your servant. That's a change in attitude. This is the guy who, however long it took him to get to the banks of the Jordan and go down and dip and throw his fit and then all, I don't know what it, how it took. An hour, who knows? Now he comes back and he calls Elisha himself to Elisha. He says, I'm your servant. That's a different man. That's a different man than an hour earlier. Do you see that? So he says, take a present from your servant, from me. But he, Elisha, says, the Lord lives before whom I stand. I will take nothing. And he urged him to take it, but he refused. Naaman said, if not, please let your servant at least be given 2 mules load of earth. For your servant will no longer offer burnt offering, nor will he sacrifice to other gods, but to the Lord. Both that statement and 6, when he says, as the Lord lives, he's the God, or 15, he's the only God there is. The issue is settled of heart loyalty. I'm all out for God. That's a result of Naaman. No longer was his attitude clouded by worrying about me. He was, there's no God like this one, and I'm not going to worship any other God ever. Why does he ask when he can't give money to Elisha? Why does he say, give me a couple bundles of dirt, you know? You go to Home Depot and get potting soil. Get to do that every spring. You know, and you're lugging dirt around. He asked, give me a couple of mule loads of dirt. Because he said, I'm not going to worship or sacrifice to any other God. Most people think, you know, he was taking something from Israel, some land, some dirt, brought it back, made himself his own place to kneel or a little family home altar. That's where he worshiped God, because then in the next verse he says, grant that I, when I have to as bodyguard, chief bodyguard for the king, grant that when I go into the house of Rimmon, the god there, and I escort him in, and I have to kneel with him because that's my job. Grant that I am pardoned for that. You know what I think this tells us? A lot of people think, well, if you get sanctified, if God makes your heart pure, this is some Mother Teresa kind of thing, and you just float around and you speak in a sort of a soft voice, and your hands are usually kind of clasped like this. And, you know, you just... No. A clean heart. You ever read about disciples? Ever read about the book of Acts? They had some pretty heated debates. They got in all kinds of situations. They faced trials and tribulations. I think what this says is Naaman went right square back. Now, there's exceptions here. He didn't go back to being a barmaid, okay? He didn't go back to bartender school. There's some occupations you got to get out of. But he went right back to where God had placed him in his life. He was chief bodyguard, 5-star general to the king. That was his job. It tells us, I believe he kept his word. I'm not going to offer sacrifice to any other god but the Lord. But it tells us that we stay in the world we're in. A lot of people think when you get heart religion, then you immediately join a monastery. And so you're not tainted with anything. No, God wants changed people. Can you imagine the difference people saw in Naaman when he got back home? Boy, he's not so pompous like he used to be. He's not expecting first place. He's different. There's something different about him. He's teachable. He's not a know-it-all. He was different. I've got to quit. But, well, there's one more quick one. Elisha's servant must have not liked his wages too much. And so he's mad that Naaman got let go without getting any money from him, because he'd offered it, and he's mad that Elisha let it go. So he chases after him, lies to Naaman. But even there, I think there's one little statement. It says, when Naaman looked behind him and saw someone running, and it was this servant, just a servant, he got out of his chariot, it says. He stepped down out of his chariot, and he went to him, and he says, is all well? Are you okay? This is Naaman, the guy that maybe a day before had come with this motorcade, and he expected, hey, I'm here. He's different. That's what a pure heart, ridding us of excessive love of me, that's what it introduces to my heart. And then God wants to go ahead, work on that, mold it, and get that influence through my whole life. But this is a wonderful illustration of the core issue of inbred sin and the results, immediate results, when God cleanses it from our hearts. Now, pray for my life as I go down the hallway, because it's 9:36, okay? I'll repent and try to do better next service. But I want us to just do this. I want us to just bow our heads in quietness for a few seconds while Dan comes to dismiss us. Anybody here just say, by just lifting your hand, I want you to say two things. One, I believe I have a need in this area. I know I'm saved. I know I'm a Christian. I'm walking with God. But I think there is a remaining infection in my heart. I want it cleansed. Anybody just say, I know that's there. I'm pretty sure it is. Help me pray and get to the place where I can diagnose this and trust God for cleansing, for the cure. Anybody just slip your hand up and acknowledge that? Thank you. God bless you. Good. Thank you. The Lord bless every one of you. He calls us never. He never calls us to something he can't do or won't do.